Now, today we can discuss about the predicate. So, in propositional logic, there is no adequate way to express the meaning in mathematical notation. So, suppose we can say that all the computers in university are connected into the local area networks. So, there is no rule to identify whether the propositional logic of this statement, the value should be generated as a true or false. So there is no truth value we can generate when the such type of statement is like that. All the students are brilliant. So we cannot say the number until and unless we cannot know the universe of discourse. So there are limitations of the propositional logics. So now we can start with the predicate logic and predicate calculus. So here, in case of predicate, we can say like X is a student. X is a, we can say, brilliant student. So here we can say X is a brilliant student. In that case, X is a universe of discourse where the value may be X, may be 1, may be 2, may be 3, may be 4, and like that. And is a brilliant student, it is treated as a predicate. So we can say in that way, is a brilliant student will be treated as a predicate. And X is treated as a universe of discourse. So here the sentence we can also write represent in the form of P of X such that X is a brilliant student. So here we cannot identify the value of X. X may be Ram, X may be Ankit, X may be Mohan. So that the value should X should not be defined. So X is treated as a universe of discourse. So here the P will be treated as a predicate, which is a brilliant student, and X will be treated as a universe of discourse. So before starting with the predicate calculus, we can say, suppose we can write X is greater than 3. In that statement is neither true nor false until and unless we cannot given the universe of discourse. So here, for a certain X value, that truth value will be generated true, and certain X value, the truth value will be generated as a false. So we can take example, we can just put X equal to 1, here 1 greater than 3. So 1 is greater than 3, it is becoming false. 2 is greater than 3, we can take a value of X equal to 2. 2 greater than 3, it is also false. Now we can take X equal to 4, and 4 is greater than 3, the value will be generated true. And 5 greater than 3, the value will be generated true. So the meaning is that for certain X value, the statement X greater than 3 is generate false value, or for remaining certain X values, it should also generate the truth value as a true. So that type of statement is neither true for all the statement and nor false. Similarly, example we can take X plus Y equal to 7. So now X plus Y equal to 7, it is a type of statement where the certain time the value will be false and certain case the value will become true. So suppose we can take the value of X equal to 1 and Y equal to 1, 1 plus 1 is not equal to 7, so it is called as a false. It is equal to 7, not equal to 7, that's why it is treated as a false. And certain X value we can take X equal to 3 and Y equal to 4. So 3 plus 4 equal to 7. So that statement is treated as a true. So for the meaning is that type of statement is given for certain value, it generates the statement truth value become true, and for certain value, it should be generated the value become false. So as we know that, for that type of statement, how it will be represented? So when the large number of statement, mathematical notation you can use and express the meaning in the large universe of discourse, we can use the concept of predicate logic. So now we can say predicate can be defined predicate can be defined with universe of discourse. So in universe of discourse means the meaning is that just suppose like the statement for all the x, p of x, we can say. The meaning is that for all the x, for every value of x, p of x is true. And the another quantifier we can use, that is existential quantifier, existential x and p of x. That is, at least one value of x, p of x become true. So, the concept is that where we can take the large number of quantities, we can use the concept of predicate calculus. So, a predicate can be defined without using universe of discourse. Universe of discourse is nothing but a set of value. If suppose we can take a normal integer value, set of real number value, set of complex value. So that is the concept of predicates. Now we can come to the next point, which is called as a quantifier. So here, in case of quantifier, we can say that there are two type of quantifier we can use. One is the universal quantifier, another is the existential quantifier. In universal quantifier, we can say it is true for all the value of x, the particular statement is true. So universal quantifier, we can say it is true for all values of statement. So it should be represented in that symbol, it is for all. But here in the existential quantifier, we can say it is true for some value. For some values it is true, or we can say at least one value. At least one value it become true, and it should be represented in the symbol of reverse E, that is the existential symbol. So this is the way in which we can define. There are two types of quantifier, one is the universal quantifier, another is the existential quantifier. So here, that is a part of universal and that is a part of the existential quantifier. So now, we can take even few examples based on the quantifier, how the statement can be represented and what is the need of this type of quantifier. Suppose we can say the statement like that, Ankit is brilliant student. Now we can take the another, Ram is brilliant student, and third we can take etc. something, few more students are brilliant. So these type of statement we can represent in the predicate calculus. So the thing is that we can say all the students are brilliant student. So that type of statement we can represent in the term of predicate calculus. We can say all student of set A are brilliant, where set A is nothing but set A is the number of students like that Ankit, Ram and something more. So these set of students, we can say all the students are treated as a brilliant student. So how it will be represented in the predicate calculus, we can take a statement like that, P of x, where x is brilliant student. And now we can take for all these students are brilliant, we can write for all of x, p of x, that is a brilliant student. So that for all we can use that is nothing but it is used the quantifier, and that can be represent the before predicate. We can use the symbol, with that symbol is called as a quantifier, and that quantifier is treated as a universal quantifier. So here the universal quantifier we can represent for all the symbol, and existential it is represent for reversing. In universal quantifier we can use the general term for all every. Suppose we can write the statement every computer is connected into a LAN, we can use as a for all symbol or universal quantifier. We can say at least one of the computer is connected to the LAN, we can use the existential quantifier. So at least one value is true, we can use existential, and for all the values true we can use the universal quantifier. So that is the difference between the universal and existential quantifier. Now we can take a one new form more example in which we can describe the universal and existential quantifier. So we can take example one, p of x, and we can take x, the number is all number or numbers are even with universe of discourse of set 1 2 3 4. So numbers are given with universe of discourse, we can given as a 1 2 3 4. So out of the set 1 2 3 4, we can say all the numbers are even. So we can check whether it is belong to, it is the statement is true or it is false. So all the numbers are even, we can say. So if for a one value we can say the p of x is false, because 1 is odd number, 2 is even, and 4 is even number. So for a sum value in a one set, there is a total 4 number of objects 1 2 3 4. For only 2 value it become a true, and for the 2 value it is not a even number, it is an odd number. So for all of x, p of x is false. So in universal quantifier we can say for all of x, the truth value of this statement is false. Another statement we can take p of x, and the next statement we can problem we can discuss here, the x is not equal to 5. The statement is x is not equal to 5, and universe of discourse of 1, 2, 3, 4. So here we observe that universe of discourse range is given 1, 2, 3, 4. Out of that, the statement p of x is not equal to 5. So x is not equal to 5, x equal to 1, 2, 3, and 4. It is not equal to 5. That means the statement is true for all the value of x 1, 2, 3, 4. So for all the value of this set of discourse value, it is true. That's why we can say for all of x of p of x is true. So the truth statement of this x not equal to 5 of universe of discourse 1, 2, 3, 4, it is true. So that is the part of the universal quantifier. Similarly, we can take the example of the existential quantifier. So that is the universal, it is true or it is false. Now we can take the example of existential quantifier. So let's, we can start with the problem p of x, x is greater than 5, and universe of discourse of 1, 2, 3, 4. So x is greater than 5, and universe of discourse we can given 1, 2, 3, 4. So what will be the value we can generate in case of existential quantifier says at least one of the value become true, then it is true. So here in the case, one value x, 1 is greater than 5, it become true. 2 is greater than 5, it become true. 3 is greater than 5, it become, so 1 is greater than 5, it is false. 2 greater than 5, it is again false. 3 greater than 5, it is false. And 4 greater than 5, it is again false. So for all the value it become a false. So what we can say, so at least one value is true, then we can say it is the existential quantifier. So similarly, we can take the p of x and even number from universe of discourse 1, 2, 3, 4. Here in this case, we can generate the all even numbers. So all even numbers, it is only 1, it is not an even number, and 3 is not an even number. 2 and 4, it is only even number. So for some value, it is true, and remaining all value, it becomes a false. So it is false from 1 and 3, and it is true for 2 and 4. That's why we can say existential x of p of x is true. So that truth value is true, but in this case all the value is false, so we can say existential x p of x is false. So that is the difference between the existential quantifier and universal quantifier. So these are the examples in which we can identify where we can apply universal quantifier and where we can apply existential quantifier. So in general way, we can say universal quantifier you can use where all the value of x, p of x is true. And for at least one of the value p of x is true, we can use the existential quantifier. So we can say like x is student. So here the is student will be treated as a predicate, and x is the nothing but which is called as a universe of discourse. So now that we have to finish about the what is a quantifier, these two type of quantifier we can use, universal and existential. Now next point we can discuss, that is a free and bound variable. Free and bound variable. So a variable which is said to be a bound if it is bound by the quantifier, and if the variable is not bound, which is called as a free variable. So a variable is said to be bound if it bound with the variable bound with quantifier and variable not bound with quantifier, it is called free variable. So when the quantifier is not bound the variable, it is called free variable, and it is bound with the quantifier, it is called as a bound variable. So here we can take which type of mathematical expression you can identify whether it is a bound or it is a free. So here we can take for all of x, p of x comma y. In that case, we can say for all of x, p of x comma y, where the x is bound and y is free. For all of x, because every x, p of x, y is true, but this no matter what the value of y has. So y is free, and only it is depend on the value of x. So for every x, p of x, y is true. Similarly, we can take in existential case, existential x p of x comma y. Here in this case also we can say x is bound and y is free. So at least one of the x, p of x y is true. So p of x y is true based on the x. At least one of the x is true. So no matter what the value of y is. If suppose we can say it is a one predicate p of x, y with more than one variable and depend both bound to both the variable, then the expression is like that. For all of x comma y, p of x, y. So here x, y both are depend bound on B of x and y. So now that is the meaning of variable is bound and variable is free. Now we can take a one example to how to symbolize a particular expression in the quantifier. So every integer is either negative or positive. So we can write in a symbolic form. Every integer either negative or positive. So there is a various way to represent that statement into a mathematical notation in the symbolic form. So let's start. Let x is a member of z, where z is nothing but a set of integers which can consist of negative values as well as positive values. So z is nothing but it can consist of negative minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 1, 2, 3 and like that. So that is the part of x is a member of z, and we can say P of x such that every integer either negative or positive. So that is every, we can must present every integer either negative or positive. So the meaning is that when we can use the term every, so every means we can use universal quantifier or existential quantifier. So we can use universal because every, all, for all that time we can use for universal quantifier. So here for every integer is either positive or negative, we can say for all of x, P of x is true. So that is the statement that every integer is either negative or positive, we can represent the universe of discourse is nothing but x is a member of z. The z is, it is consist of universe of discourse both negative value as well as positive value. And every integer is either negative or positive. So then every integer, we can say for all of x, P of x is true. Now the another way we can take x is a member of z, and we can take P of x, where we can say if when x is an integer, that is the one way in which we can represent. Second way, x is positive integer and Q of x, we can say x is negative integer, where x is nothing but is a member of set of integer. So now how it, another way we can represent in the form of every integer is either negative or positive. So we can represent P of x or Q of x means x is positive or it is negative. Then every x, for all of x, P of x or Q of x. So the same sentence we can represent in different symbolic form. One, for all of x, P of x, where P of x is every integer either positive or negative. Another way we can represent x is a positive and x is negative because we can use or. So here we can use the concept of restriction. So P of x or Q of x for all of x. Now another way we can use x, we can take the third way, P of x, x be an integer and Q of x, we can say x is either positive or negative integer. So, and that is x is a member of z, so that we can also represent in the form of for all of x, p of x implies q of x. So there are different ways to represent the same sentence. Every integer is either positive or negative. We can represent in three ways of symbolic form. So that is the way in which how the particular sentence we can represent in the form of predicate and universal and quantifier. So next point we can discuss the removing of quantifier for the statement. So next is removing quantifier from predicate. How to remove quantifier from predicate? So here we can apply the De Morgan law and in which we can convert the quantifier from the predicates. So let's P of x that P of x is the predicate. And universe of discourse is set of x1, x2 up to xn. Universe of discourse we can give an x1, x2, x3 up to xn, and P of x is the predicate. Now, for all of x, first we can take the removing quantifier. For all of x, P of x, which is logically equivalent to, here the meaning of this for all of x, P of x, for every x, P of x is true. So we can represent in the form of removing quantifier, we can write P of x1 and P of x2 and P of x3 up to so on and P of x of n. Similarly, in existential x, P of x, that is equivalent to, that is at least one of the x, P of x is true. So when at least one of the x, P of x is true, it is nothing but it is used the OR operation. So it is equal to P of x1 or P of x2 or P of x3 and so on or P of xn. So that is, we can just remove the quantifier, both universal and existential quantifier. So now, this is we can call as a equation number 1 and it is the equation number 2. Now we want to eliminate, we can apply De Morgan in equation 1. And first in equation 1 we can apply De Morgan, it is negation for all of x, P of x. Now, when we can apply the De Morgan law, it is treated as a negation P of x1 and negation P of x2 and so on and P of xn. Again, in this case we can apply the De Morgan law again in the second equation, in equation 2, apply De Morgan, we get negation E existential x of P of x, which is equal to negation P of x1 or negation P of x2 and so on or negation P of xn. So that is the removing the quantifier in case of where the negation should be exist or without the negation should be exist. So in that case, when we can apply the De Morgan law, so it will be treated as a for all of x negation. So it is OR and it will be generated OR. In that case, it is AND. as we know, because for negation for all of x, p of x, which is equal to p of x1 negation or negation p of x2 and so on to negation p of xn. So now we can just convert the conjunction with disjunction and disjunction in the conjunction. So that is the removing quantifier from the predicates. So next we can come to negation of the quantifier. How the quantifier statement, we can perform the negation of the quantifier statement. So next one, negation of quantifier. So when a quantifier statement is given, then you can perform the negation of the quantifier. Suppose the statement we can take one, all math major are male. So all the math major are male. What is the negation of this statement as? Negation as is that it is not case that all math major are male, or we can say, or we can also write, at least one math major are female. So the statement is like that all math major are male. What is the negation? It is not the case that all the math major are male. It is also negation as, or it is also equivalent to at least one math major which is female. So that type of statement we can represent in the symbolic form of mathematical notation. We can say negation for all x is a member of n, where m is a male, m is a math major, and we can say x is male. So when all math major are male, we want to perform negation for all of x is a member of n. We can perform a negation where x is nothing but a universe of discourse where it consists of all male. So it is equivalent to existential x is a member of n and x is negation of x is male, or x is, we can say, negation of x is a member of a male, and that is the negation. So the negation is indicated for the x is not a male. So we can also equivalent expression, we can write down x is a member of n, x is male, which is equivalent to existential and x is not male. So that is the statement we can write. So now that statement we can convert in the form of p of x. So where we can say p of x, x is male. So here the statement is, for all of x is a member of n, p of x, which is equivalent to existential x is a member of n, negation of p of x. So that is the expression we can write down, where p of x is nothing but the x is a male. So now the next one, we can apply the De Morgan law again here in that case. So what we can generate? Negation for all of x, which is, we can treat it as a member of A, p of x, which is equivalent to existential x is a member of A, negation of p of x. And in the other case, we can take, if suppose that is a negation, x is a member of A, P of x, which is also equivalent to, for all of x is a member of A and negation of P of x, after applying the De Morgan law. So, that is, in that case, you can find the how to perform the negation of the quantifier statement. So now, next is the negation of statement with more than one variable or with three variable, propositional variable, we can perform the next point. So negation quantifier statement, negation of quantifier statement with more than one variable. We can perform the negation of quantifier statement with more than one variable. So here we can take an example. For all of x, negation y, negation z, comma p of x, comma y, comma z, and we can perform the negation of the statement. So how we can perform the negation of the three proposition variable x, y and z, and we can perform the negation? There is a certain step you have to remember in your mind while you can converting the negation of the more than one variable. So whenever we can use the universal quantifier, you can convert into the existential quantifier, and whenever there is an existential quantifier, you can convert into the universal quantifier. So that is the procedure. So what is the step by step we can come? First step is that this is the first variable, universal quantifier. It will convert into the existential quantifier, then negation, and we can take the complete in this parenthesis. The existential y, existential z, comma p of x, comma y, comma z. What is the next step? Next step is that existential x, it is existential y, negation is universal y, and we can take negation existential z, comma p of x, y and z. Now next step is existential x, universal y, it is again universal z, comma negation p of x, y and z. So that is the way in which we can convert more than one proposition variable into the negation quantified statement. So here the universal come to existential, existential come to universal, existential come to universal, and it is come in the form of negation, negation of p of x, comma y, comma z. So that is the way in which we can perform more than one variable, we can negation. Now, next we can perform about the inference theory of predicate calculus. So next we can discuss about the inference theory of predicate calculus. The inference theory generally we can use to check the fact about the statement, or we want to check the validity of the argument, we can use the concept of inference theory. And finally, based on the premises, when the premises all are true, we can find the conclusion, conclusion also true. When a conclusion is true, we can say the argument is valid, otherwise we can say it is a fallacy. So there is a certain rules we are incorporating in a predicate calculus to easily identify whether the conclusion is reaches correct or it is incorrect. So there is certain addition and deletion predicate calculus we can use, which is used as a addition and deletion quantifier. So first we can use universal specification. In universal specification, we can say for all of x, P of x is the premises, and we can find therefore conclusion P of C, where C is nothing but a certain element where P of x is true. C is an where P of C is true. So C is any number, or we can say any quantity in which where the we can say P of C is true. So either quantity, or we can say it is an element where P of C is true. First is the universal specification. So it is used where certain premises are there, P of x to Q of x, and it is true for one P of C. So we can write the P of C to Q of C. So that we have to come into the problem. The different type of problem we can discuss after the inference theory of predicate calculus. We can discuss how that can be applicable for solving the problem. So now the next one is, one is the universal, another is the existential specification. So in case of existential specification, we can use existential x of P of x, and therefore it is P of C. In case of universal, we can use for all. In existential, we can use existential x of P of x, and therefore the generate P of C, where C is an element where we can say P of C is true. So C is an element where P of C is true. So it is, what is the difference between this universal quantifier and existential quantifier? In universal, we can use for all of x P of x. So C is an element where P of C is true in universe of discourse. But it is an element where P of C is true, it is called as an existential quantifier. Now third one is that universal generalization. So third one is universal generalization. In universal generalization, we can use P of x, and therefore for all of x, P of x. It is called as a P of x is true, then conclusion is for all of x, P of x become true. And fourth one is, we can call as a existential generalization. In existential generalization, we can use P of x, existential x of P of x. So here we can use at least one of the value, it becomes true, P of C upon existential x of P of x. So there are total four we can use the specification. One is the universal existential, universal generalization, and universal existential generalization. So these are used in case of, we can solve the problem to check the validity of the argument and finally conclude is reaches whether it is valid or it is fallacy. So how to solve? We can take one more problem in which we can more clear how to that equation should be used while solving the problem in predicate calculus. So the problem is that to check the validity of argument, that is the problem number one, check the validity of the argument. First, all educated are all graduates are educated. Now first sentence is all graduates are educated. Second one, Ram is graduate Ram is graduate and therefore the sentence is Ram is educated. Therefore, Ram is educated. So that is the sentence which we can represent in normal English sentence, and you can convert into the with the help of mathematical notation. You can check whether the argument is valid or not. So these are the sentences you have to convert into the form of predicate calculus. All graduates are educated. So how it will be represented? We can take let z of x, where x is graduate, and we can take e of x such that x is educated. It is the predicate we can use. So I think you have clear about the concept why we can use the z of x and e of x. Is educated is treated as a predicate, and x is treated as a universe of discourse. But here, of course, it's given all the graduates are educated. So whenever we can use term all, every, it is used the universal quantifier. But in this case, there is two term we are using, graduate, are educated. So one, we can take z of x, where x is a graduate, and e of x, x is a educated. Now, the one is the Ram is a graduate. So we can take Ram as a variable, we can treat it as a variable R. So we can say is a graduate, so z of R. And therefore, next is Ram is a educated. So finally, conclusion we can find, which is Ram is educated, that is z of E. So what are the premises are there? So we can generate the following premises. Premises are all graduate are educated. So means graduate are educated. The meaning is that if the z of x implies to e of x, or g of x implies to e of x, that is the premise number one. What is the second premise? Second premise is that the Ram is graduate. So it is treated z of r, and therefore conclusion is z of e. So now, based on the premises, we can find whether the z of e is true or false. So how to solve this type of problem? So first one, we can take premise is z of x implies to e of x. Here, apply universal specification. When we can apply the universal specification, what we get? We can get z of r implies e of r. As we know, what is the universal specification? It is for all of x, p of x, and it is true for p of c. It is true for p of c. So we can take, apply universal specification. It is generate g of r implies to e of r. Now the second premise is, which is g of r. So now what we can generate here? All graduates are educated. So g of x graduate implies to e of x. Second, Ram is a graduate. So Ram is a graduate. Therefore, Ram is a educated. So it is not. It is come under e of r. It should also come. Ram is a educated. Education of the person is variable is r. That is Ram. Ram is a educated. So now, in the case here, in this premises and this premises, what the law we can apply to generate finally e of r? So here, in this case, we can apply Modus Ponens law, and Modus Ponens law says if g of r and g of r implies to e of r, it is generally e of r. Apply Modus Ponens, we can find e of r, and e of r is the conclusion. We can say argument is valid. So that type of sentence is given, and you can finally convert based on the universal specification and Modus Ponens law. We can generate the expression is valid. So that is one type of problem. Now the another problem. We can again check the validity of the grammar or argument. All educated persons are well behaved. All educated persons are well behaved. The another sentence is that Ram is educated. Ram is educated, and then the no well behaved person is no well behaved person is quarrelsome, and the final result therefore Ram is not quarrelsome. Ram is not quarrelsome. So that is the again that type of problem we can solve based on the inference rules and predicate calculus, because all educated persons are well behaved. So let's we can take that universe of discourse is set of all educated person. So that is the solution we can take. Or let we can take universe of discourse is all educated persons. So now next one we can take the P of X, where X is well behaved and Rob is educated. Next we can take Y variable, where Ram is educated and no well behaved person is called son. So we can take Q of X such that X is a called son. So first of all, what we can do, whatever the sentence is given, we can represent in the form of predicate. We can represent in the form of predicate means we can, here we can use P of X, X is a well behaved, and in universe of discourse we can take all educated persons. Second point we can take, let's find any variable where Ram is educated, and the third point we can take Q of X, where the person is not a quarrelsome, or we can say X is a quarrelsome. So that one thing you have to remember in your mind, whenever the sentence we can represent in the mathematical notation, then not represent in the negation form. First we can represent X is a quarrelsome. So if suppose X is not a quarrelsome, then we can represent in the form of negation of Q of X. So the finally conclusion we can generate, the Ram is not a quarrelsome. So now the premises become, the premises are, first premises is that he, all educated persons are well behaved. So we can represent in the form of, for all of X, P of X is true. For all of X, P of X is true. That means all educated persons are well behaved. So now here we can apply again the certain law after the, we can generate the conclusion. So next one we can take the Y is a, another variable where the Ram is educated, and third one, no well behaved person is quarrelsome. So that sentence we can represent, it is well behaved person is not a quarrelsome. So it should be represented in the form of, for all of x, p of x implies to negation q of x, because p of x is a well behaved. All well behaved implies to quarrelsome, negation of quarrelsome. That is not a quarrelsome. The meaning is that no well behaved person is quarrelsome. It will be represented in the form of, for all of x, p of x implies to negation of q of x. And therefore we can say Ram is not a quarrelsome. So therefore result is negation q of y. That we want to find the conclusion. So how to solve this type of problem? Again, we can use the first one. We can take for all of x, p of x. First one we can take for all of x, p of x, and we can take Ram is educated. It is treated as a p of y. It is true for one value. So here we can use the universal specification. When we can apply universal specification, and universal specification says for all of x, p of x, it is true for p of c, where c is an element of universe of discourse, where c is element of universe of discourse. So it is a p of y. Then next we can take for all of x, p of x implies to p negation q of x. Here again we can apply the universal specification. So again apply universal specification, we get p of y implies to negation q of y. So now one expression is this one and another is the p of y. Now we can apply the law of, we can use it called as a Wallace-Fonnell law, and we get it is p of y, and p of y implies to negation q of y. We can find negation q of y, and negation q of y is nothing but it is the conclusion. So negation q of y, it is the final conclusion, and we can say the argument is valid. So based on the expression we can find that our argument is valid. So how to solve this type of problem? First, you can understood, if suppose it is a type of propositional calculus or predicate calculus, when we are using all, every, at least one term, that term is using, that means you can identify that type of problem based on the predicate calculus. Now you can convert into the predicate form. Now after we can write the premises and finally conclusion. Based on the premises you can apply the inference rules for the simplify the expression and to finally generate the conclusion. When the finally conclusion is right, we can say the argument is valid. Otherwise, we can say the argument is a fallacy. So that is the way in which we can find out the argument in the predicate calculus. So similar way, we can also generate the argument. Also in the same way, we can generate the argument in the propositional logic. So one problem we can again discuss, that is the validity of the argument. So check the validity of argument. So here if x is, if x has completed BE or MBA, then he got good job. If X is assured a good job, if X is assured a good job, then he is happy. That is a problem. And the X is not happy, and X is not happy, therefore X has not completed MBA. X has not completed MBA. So that is the another type of problem which we can check the validity of the argument. But here when we can say it is specified for the X variable, so that problem should not solve by the predicate, it is solved by the propositional calculus. In propositional calculus we can also use the rule of inference. So we can use the modus ponens, modus tollens law and simplification law and chain rules like that. So here we can take one proposition variable P. We can say X has completed B. In Q proposition variable we can say X has completed MBA, and R, the proposition variable R, we can say it is found a good job and assured a good job and X is happy. So I think these are only four variables we are using. X is completed B or MBA, then B got good job. Second sentence, if X is assured a good job, then he is happy. And X is not happy, therefore X has not completed MBA. So now that sentence we can represent in the form of propositional variable. So here we can take X has completed B, Q, it is for MBA, and R propositional variable indicate X assured a good job, and S is indicate X is a happy. So now what are the premises? So premises is X has completed BE or MBA. That means either BEP or Q. P means X completed BE, Q, X completed MBA. P or Q, then he got good job. That means implies to R that is got a good job. Now, that is the first premises are there. Second, if X is assured a good job, that means it is R assured a good job, then he is happy. That means implies to S. And third one, X is not happy, that is negation S. And finally conclusion becomes says X has not completed MBA. So that is negation Q is the conclusion. So now it is a very interesting problem. So whatever the problem should say, you can step by step you can solve the problem. So first the sentence we can convert into the proposition variable, then we can represent in the whatever they can say. Completed B or MBA, P or Q implies to R, assured a good job for R, then he is happy, implication implies S, he is not happy, negation S, and finally conclusion X has not completed MBA, that is negation Q. So based on the three premises we can find the conclusion, it become negation Q. So here we can use the different type of inference rule. So you can observe that while we can use the premises 1, P or Q implies to R and R implies to S. This is the premises 1, this is the premises 2. Which law we can apply to solve this simplification of the expressions? So here we can use the chain rule. Chain rule, or we can say rule of transitivity, or we can say hypothesis, supposition. These are the three means we can apply this rule, and that rule says if P implies Q, Q implies R, then therefore P implies to R. So P or Q implies to R and R implies to S, we can say the final output is that is a P or a Q implies to S. So now the next premise is, third is negation S. So here we can apply in this one, in this expression we can apply Modus Tollens. When we can apply the Modus Tollens theorem in P or Q implies S and negation S, then what we can generate? We can generate the negation of P or Q. Now, after applying the Modus Tollens theorem, we can find negation P or Q. Here we can apply the De Morgan law. De Morgan law says negation of P or Q equal to negation P and negation Q. So it should generate negation P and negation Q. Now, after we can apply simplification law. So the simplification law says P or Q, therefore we can generate the P. So it is generate negation Q. So that is the final conclusion, and in which we can say the argument is valid. Because this is the negation Q, and we can find this is the also negation Q. So we can solve based on the apply the different type of law, and we can finally generate the answer. The argument is valid. So that type of things we can discuss here. The how to solve the validity of the argument based on the predicate and based on the propositional calculus. So in next class we can discuss about the different type of proof methods. Thank you.